morning. Oh, I'll try that again. Good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome to our Epiphany carol service. We're going to start with the words of Psalm 45. My heart is stirred by a noble theme as I recite my verses for the King. My tongue is the pen of a skillful writer. You are the most excellent of men, and your lips have been anointed with grace, since God has blessed you forever. Gird your sword on your side, you mighty one. Clothe yourself with splendour and majesty. In your majesty, ride forth victoriously in the cause of truth, humility and justice. Let your right hand achieve awesome deeds. Let your sharp arrows pierce the hearts of the king's enemies. Let the nations fall beneath your feet. Your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. A scepter of justice will be the scepter of your kingdom. You love righteousness and hate wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has set you above your companions by anointing you with the oil of joy. All your robes are fragrant with myrrh and aloes and cassia. From palaces adorned with ivory, the music of the strings makes you glad. Daughters of kings are among your honoured women. At your right hand is the royal bride in gold of Ophir. Listen, daughter, and pay careful attention. Forget your people and your father's house. Let the king be enthralled by your beauty. Honour him, for he is your lord. The city of Tyre will come with a gift. People of wealth will seek your favour. All glorious is the princess within her chamber. Her gown is interwoven with gold. In embroidered garments she is led to the king. Her virgin companions follow her, those brought to be with her. Led in with joy and gladness, they enter the palace of the king. Your sons will take the place of your fathers. You will make them princes throughout the land. I will perpetuate your memory through all generations. Therefore, the nations will praise you forever and ever. So let us join in with a song of praise as we sing together the first Noel.
Thank you.
have a few notices for us before we go any further. Firstly, to say I do hope you'll be able to come and join us for a drink after the service. We'll be across in the church hall, so just follow the direction if you're not sure where that is. Also, today we are in Matthew's Gospel, and some of you may remember that a few weeks ago I did an order of some Matthew scripture journals, so you have the text of Matthew on one side and the space to make notes on the other. If you would like one of those and you didn't order one, I have one going spare. So these are £1. So if you're interested, come and grab it during one of the hymns. I'll leave it on the front there. So do use that if you think that would be useful to you. A few communications just to let you know about. We had a nice email from Ben Frampton yesterday thanking us for our good wishes for them for Christmas. He thanks us that we were remembering them over the Christmas period, and they were able to have a nice relaxing week at home on leave. I've also had a card from Step thanking us for our support as well. So I will leave this at the front. So if anyone wants to come and have a look at that card from Step after the service, do please have a look through there. The card was drawn by one of the Syrian refugees, so do come and have a look at that. On Thursday, I'll get the dates right eventually, B3A is taking place, the first one of the new year. It's at 2:30, not 2 o'clock, as I put in the prayer newsletter. Just wanted to see who was paying attention. Full master tuning for spotting it early. So it is 2 o'clock in the 2:30, so you did correctly, 2:30 in the church hall across there. So if you want to check out where that is, coming across for a coffee at the end of the service is a good way to find it. So do please remember that. Final notice, I know there's been a lot this morning. In 2 weeks' time, it is our fourth Sunday service, and we're going to be thinking about temptation, and very particularly the account of Jesus' temptation in the desert. If anybody has any craft ideas for that, I would be very appreciative. I am on leave from Wednesday, so if you can have a think over the next couple of days, and if you think of anything, let me know by the end of Tuesday. That would be really helpful. Well, I thought we'd do something a bit different this morning. During lockdown, we did things a bit differently, and I ran a competition during lockdown called Where's Ben? It is in no way similar to Where's Wally for copyright reasons, but it was you trying to find me in a picture, and it was a picture of my avatar going, and you had to try and find me in Times Square. So we've done a kind of virtual version of that. I thought it was about time that we did a physical version of that. So again, you were looking for my avatar, not me, because it's a bit easy as I'm sitting at the front. So if you are one of our younger people in the church, I'm going to give you about a minute to run around and see if you can find my avatar smiling and waving at you. You've got about a minute. If anyone else wants to join in that is slightly older, that is absolutely fine as well. A minute, off you go. See if you can find me hidden somewhere in the church. Okay, I think our minute is up. Do we need some help, maybe?
Well, I was thinking about our story today, the account of the wise men, and they were given a star to help them find the thing they were looking for. I can't arrange a star, but I do have a torch. So, hopefully, if we look at where the torch is, we might, I'll try not to shine it in anyone's eyes, apologies in advance, we might be able to spot where we are looking. So, let's see if we can follow the torch. You need to try and follow where I'm going with the torch. I'd walk and follow it as well, because otherwise it might disappear. Oh, that's me, it's good in that direction. Let's have a look, so keep going.
To him, and he will save us.
Lord, we thank you that you do reveal Jesus to us in your word. And we thank you that we can come around your word in different ways to learn more and understand more about Jesus. We thank you that we can come in formal ways like this. We thank you that we can come to study your word, such as our Bible studies, either the one on a Tuesday evening or the Ladies' Prayer and Bible study on a Thursday. We thank you that we can go elsewhere and tell people your word. And we very particularly pray for Peter this afternoon as he preaches at Stanford. And we pray for the Brendan Care Service tomorrow. We thank you that we can go in and help those older people in the town to understand more of Jesus. But we thank you that Jesus came for everyone. So we thank you also for the youth evening that happened on Friday, that we can come together and have fun, but also learn more about Jesus and the difference he makes to our lives. And Lord, we thank you that also we are bound together. We become a family when we trust in him. So we thank you that we can come together for times of fellowship and in different ways. So we thank you for B3A that restarts this week. We thank you for Treasure Seekers that takes place tomorrow. Lord, we just pray that you would bless all these things and help us to come to know Jesus better and become more like Jesus. Lord, we thank you that we can pray for one another. I thank you for the prayers from my brothers and sisters, and Anne and I are the prayer focus this week, and we do very much pray for Felicity as well. We thank you for her, and we pray that you will bless her and keep her very close to you. And Lord, we thank you that Jesus, while he was here, came partly as a teacher to reveal himself to us. And we thank you for the different things he did teach, including the prayer that he taught his disciples that we can say together. The version we use is in our order of service. So let's say together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, before our young people go out to their groups, I'm going to sing again of the one who was born king, Away in a Manger. today, as well as being the text for our Epiphany carol service, starts a series towards the start of Matthew's Gospel. Up until Easter, we're going to be thinking about Jesus' early life and ministry, and then after Easter, we're going to be concentrating on the Sermon on the Mount. So our passage today is Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. Do please follow through with me as I read into us. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the peoples, chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Shall we come again to a time of prayer? Dear Lord, we thank you that we can be here today and we can think about your word. We thank you that we remember the events of Epiphany that we so often associate with the Christmas story in general. And we thank you for this time of year. Lord, we know it's often said to be a time of peace and goodwill to all men. But we are painfully aware that so often that doesn't prove to be the case. And once again, we are saddened to see the wickedness that is in the world this morning. Well, many of us have been shocked by the events of the shooting of the teacher in the US, shot by a six-year-old child. Even more shocking than the fact that a child was able to get his hands on the gun is the fact we are told it was not an accidental shooting. Lord, we don't know all the circumstances of this, but we know what a difficult and distressing situation that will be for all those that were involved. We pray for the teacher who has life-threatening injuries, and we thank you that they seem to be improving, and we pray that will continue. We thank you that the accounts that we have heard show how selfless she was, wanting to protect the other children. Lord, we pray for them, as I'm sure this will scar them for some time into the future. Lord, bring your comfort, we pray, in this difficult situation. Lord, we know there are many different ways that we hurt one another, many different ways that we are wicked and don't love our fellow man. We think about what's happening in Iran at the moment, where protesters are being killed under what we understand are thin excuses. Lord, again, bring comfort and bring peace to that place, we do very particularly pray. And as we think about loss of life and wickedness, we are once again reminded of Ukraine and praying for the difficult situation there. Lord, we know there was supposed to be a ceasefire that took place, and we also know whatever was being said didn't seem to materialise physically in the land. Lord, again, we pray that you would bring calm to that situation, that you would strengthen those involved, that you would bring comfort, and that you would speak to the hearts of those in authority. So when they talk of peace, it won't just be something they say, but something that their hearts are set on. Lord, we pray for all those grieving this morning, having lost loved ones, or those separated from loved ones. We pray comfort for them too. Lord, as we think about people who make these policies, we are reminded of our own King and his government. We thank you for them. We know that the Bible tells us you place people into authority. And we pray that they would have wisdom and that they would know that they are in authority because you have put them in, and that you are the greater authority. Lord, we pray for wisdom, particularly as they are dealing with lots of different situations of unrest in our country, albeit displayed in very different ways. And we very particularly pray for the NHS this morning. We thank you, we know how so many of us have benefited from the NHS. But we also know there are difficulties and the stress that people who work in it are under. And we know that some people are not getting the care that the NHS themselves would want them to have. So Lord, we do pray for them, we pray for strength for those working, and we pray that you would guide this country in a way to support it better. Lord, we again are saddened to hear of a child killing their mother, an older son this time killing his mother elsewhere in the country. Lord, we just pray that you would turn the hearts of wickedness to hearts of love, and particularly that people would find the Lord Jesus, that he would transform their lives. And Lord, we do pray as our young people are out in their Sunday school groups and for us as we are here, that you would be with us and you would soften our hearts and open our eyes and ears to the truths we hear from your word. Be with us and help us to understand what we look at today. We do pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we return to our passage in Matthew, let's sing again. We Three Kings of Orient Are.
Thank you.
front of you. I must confess to being a bit cheeky when we sang that last carol on the flat screen as part of our pop-up carols this year. I introduced the carol and then I turned to those people by me quietly and said, we don't know there were three, they may not have been kings and they may not have come from the Orient. But apart from that, truth be told, there is a lot we don't really know about this passage, and there is a lot of tradition that has grown up around it. Matthew is the only gospel writer who mentions this visit from the Magi, and they are never mentioned again. So why does he choose to include this account? Although there is much that is left uncertain, it does tell us some great truths of Jesus and the impact that he continues to make to our lives today. We will start in verses 1 to 2 by seeing the one born king. The one born king. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. Matthew does not really give us any detail about the actual birth of Jesus, just rather a glimpse of what happens before it and now what happens after it. We'll be thinking a little bit more later in our Sunday evening gathering about why that might be. And so the words, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, come somewhat abruptly. Matthew is not worried about the finer details of the journey to Bethlehem, or the reason for it, or even the on-site accommodation. The important thing to know is that Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the town of David. It anchors us in a place, and it gives us some idea as to a time the account took place as well. We are told that it was during the time of King Herod. That is, Herod the Great, as he came to be known. But then as soon as this is established, Matthew moves our attention to others as he tells us that Magi came to Jerusalem from the east. Were they kings? How many were there? What were their names? Where in the east did they come from? Matthew doesn't tell us, presumably because he doesn't think it is important for us to know. The term Magi originally was used to describe priests in Persia, but later it became applied to magicians and astrologers more generally. And that would certainly fit with what we see here, doesn't it? The fact that the Magi were attracted by a star. But this was no ordinary star. It was on the basis of this star that the Magi knew a king had been born. And in fact, they called it his star. In his gospel, John writes, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And the true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. John 1, verses 5 and 9. The Magi saw a literal light representing Jesus rising to mark his birth. A wonderful illustration of these verses. And perhaps for some of us, when we hear this, our mind goes to those verses in Numbers, and particularly to the prophecy from Balaam. I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel. Numbers 24, verse 17. We are already given this air of something that was foretold actually taking place. And that will become even more apparent in our next section. Now, I'm not going to go into any detail here about what the star may or may not have been. If you are interested in that, do please read Julian's article on the church website or see Julian, and I'm sure he'll be more than happy to recommend a book for you to read about it. The important thing to is that God used this star like a sign to announce Jesus' birth in a way that was recognized by these Magi. And it made them travel a long distance to search for the one who had been born. Something in the star told them that this would be the King of the Jews. And so it's not surprising that they travelled to Jerusalem, the capital city, to find him. It was the place of the palace and the temple, and it's what they would have expected. When I was at St. Lawrence School on Thursday, I asked the children, if I wanted to go and find King Charles right now, at this very moment, where should I go to? And they all said, without knowing at all where he actually was, you should go to London. And when I said why, they said, because it is the capital. That is where we might expect to find the king. I think we often assume that the Magi head straight to the palace. But Matthew doesn't actually tell us that. We learn later that Herod had to call the Magi to him. So perhaps they just arrive and start asking people on the street. Perhaps they assume that something this momentous, that this star has appeared, surely everyone will know and be able to answer their questions. And notice what it is that they did ask. Not where is the one that is born to become King of the Jews, but where is the one born King? He holds that status from the moment of his birth. King Charles had to wait 73 years before he became king. And he is not the only one that had to wait to become king. Herod himself was not from the kingly line of David. In fact, he was only half Jewish, half Idumean, and was made by king by the occupying Roman forces in 40 BC. He was certainly not born King of the Jews. He was made king by men, unlike the child that was born, who was chosen by God to be king. The Magi had not travelled hundreds of miles to come and worship Herod, but they had come to worship the child. The one who was born king, and who was, as we are told in verses 3 to 8, the foretold ruler and shepherd. The foretold ruler and shepherd. Verses 3 to 6. When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all of Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. In Bethlehem in Judea, they replied, for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. It's not hard to see why Herod was so disturbed by the words of the Magi. Maybe we can imagine the royal officials hearing these stories about the foreign men from the people in the streets and tentatively trying to tell Herod what they had heard. Because of his own ancestry and the way by which he became king, he would have been very concerned about a legitimate king coming, one from the line of David, the rightful heir to the throne, because he knew that it would challenge his position. Perhaps he was aware of some of the stories he had heard, that it had always been said that someone would come. I'm sure we have all seen, either on the TV or in films, or maybe we've either experienced it or witnessed it ourselves, that the boss of a company becoming threatened by a young up-and-coming worker who they fear one day take their place. When Fabiano was here with us in the summer, he mentioned that even some of those trained for the ministry were afraid to train up others because they were worried they would come and take their place before they were ready to retire. If even those who are called by scripture to train up others are disturbed by people taking over from them, it's no wonder that Herod is so disturbed. And a disturbed Herod also means a disturbed people. As here we are told that all Jerusalem was disturbed with him. Herod had a reputation. He was jealous and violent. It is said that he murdered his wife, his firstborn son, and other members of his family. People could only wait in horror to see how this tyrant king would react. How sad that they didn't reflect on the news they were actually told, this fulfillment of God's word, but rather they were focusing on their earthly circumstances. Something that I'm sure each one of us has done at one time or another, when we should be coming in praise and worship to our Heavenly Father for his faithfulness and love towards us. Herod may have been king, but he didn't have the knowledge of a king appointed by God. And so he summons the chief priests and the teachers of the law. I find it interesting that Matthew chooses to call them the people's priests and teachers, maybe suggesting that the detachment of the king from the religious life of the nation. Another reminder that he was not God's king in the way the baby born king of the Jews would be. He relied on priests and teachers to read the prophecies of Micah, echoing words from the book of 2 Samuel, saying that a ruler would come from Bethlehem, and he would not only be a ruler, but a shepherd. Now Herod most certainly did rule the people. The commentator William Barclay once said, he was the only ruler of Palestine who ever succeeded in keeping the peace and in bringing order into this order. But he ruled by force and fear. He certainly wasn't a loving shepherd taking care of his flock. But God's chosen king, the Messiah, would be. After all, it had been foretold. As we will see as we look through the start of the Gospel of Matthew, fulfillment of the words of the Lord is an important theme. And here we are reminded that Jesus was a fulfillment of the prophet's words. What a wonderful reassurance that should be, or should have been, to the Lord's people. Recently we saw in the book of Jeremiah the wonderful promises that God made to his people about the righteous branch that would come, the new covenant that would be ushered in. Luke in his gospel speaks of the good news of great joy for all the people, and we see the joy of the shepherds. But as yet, joy is not the overwhelming feeling we are left with in this passage. It certainly isn't for Herod, and so he decides that he has to act. Verses 7 to 8. Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." Herod sees that he will need to act if he wants to maintain his throne, and so he needs information. So he secretly calls the Magi. Isn't that interesting? He doesn't want people to know that he is meeting with them. Perhaps meeting with them would have suggested to the people that he believed their words. Of course, the truth is he did. He believed, but failed to respond in the way he should have. He wants to know exactly when the star had appeared, presumably so he could work out how old the child might now be. So he sends them on to Bethlehem, a journey of around 5 miles, and tells them to search carefully for the child. Surely that's a bit redundant, isn't it? I mean, yes, he did have to tell them to go to Bethlehem, but did he really have to tell them to search carefully? They had just travelled for what was probably hundreds of miles to get to Jerusalem. Did he really think that the final 5 miles just might be a little bit too much effort? Or did he think they might get there and just give a cursory glance in a few easy-to-find places and then just give up? But of course, this is his jealousy and paranoia speaking. He needs them to find the child, so he tells them that as soon as they find him, they should report back to him so that he can go and worship. Now, perhaps I'm reading too much into this, but doesn't this already give a hint that what Herod claims is not particularly true? After all their travelling to worship the one born king, what would we expect them to do as soon as they find him? Surely, it is worshipping themselves. And surely that's what Herod should expect them to do. But rather, he has turned it around so it is about him. And if he was that desperate to find the child and go and worship him, then why doesn't he just go with him? Go and search himself. Because he has other plans that he has to make and prepare for. The presence of anyone associated with Herod would no doubt make the people very nervous. So he puts his trust in the Magi, who have no reason not to trust him, not to take him at their word. And so they continue their search for the child who, in verses 9 to 12, we see is the one worshipped by nations. The one worshipped by nations. After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they return to their country by another route. Having been told where they need to go, the Magi waste no time in getting on the move. And as a wonderful confirmation of what they've been told, they once again see Jesus' star shining to guide them. And as soon as they saw it, they were overjoyed. There's such a contrast here, isn't there, between Herod, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, the people, and the Magi. Here is the joy that we might have expected to see from God's people, but we just don't. They are either disturbed or not really sure what that other word is. Perhaps disinterested, maybe. Isn't it amazing that the chief priests and teachers of the law can recite the words of the prophet, but then when someone suggests those actions have actually been fulfilled, we're not told that they do anything. There's no emotion described here. There's no further action that is suggested. If we're honest, they respond in the same way as many do today when we try and share with them the good news of Jesus Christ. They seem to miss how this is good news for them. We know from elsewhere in Scripture that chief priests and teachers of the law thought themselves as righteous, that is, right with God. And so they didn't see that they needed any help from anyone. Why would they need a saviour to save them when they could save themselves? Of course, they had failed to see just how sinful they are, as sinful as we all are, and as many people still fail to see. They don't see that they do need saving as we all need saving. And there is only one person that can do that. The one born King of the Jews. The Saviour born in the town of David. The one who is the good shepherd who will lay down his life for his sheep. As he did on the cross for the forgiveness of sins before being raised from the dead and bringing the promise of eternal life. Jesus may have been born King of the Jews, it's not the Jewish people we're told here go searching to worship him. Again, as John says at the start of his gospel, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. John 1, verses 11 to 13. When they did come to the house, seeing Jesus with Mary, the Magi bowed down and worshipped. Now that word worship at the time could have just meant paying homage to a king. Did they realise that this king was the Son of God? Well, we don't really know. But they certainly went a long way and went to a lot of means to worship him. And it is striking that they do worship him when his own people course, that rejection by so many was something we continue to see throughout Jesus' life. And it was eventually what led him to the cross. But for now, by the manger, he is worshipped as he should be. He's brought costly gifts of gold, frankincense and myrrh. Gifts that were fitting to a king and the type of expense that showed that they might have been given by kings. And that is probably why we have the tradition of the Magi being called kings. And because of the three gifts, in time people assumed that there were three of them. Should we associate these gifts with something symbolic? Gold for a king, frankincense used often by priests and so speaks of the divine, and myrrh used to embalm the dead? But I'm not sure the Magi deliberately chose the gifts for those reasons. There is some evidence to say that things like myrrh was a gift of joy in the Old Testament. We heard it earlier in the psalm we started our service with, being given to the king. But perhaps their worship, their gifts, and their actions spoke more of what they really understood themselves. There's a lot more I want to know from Matthew about this passage that he doesn't tell. Just how were they of what was going on? How long did they stay? Well, Matthew tells us here that it happened in half an hour or less. Did they really come all that way, spend such a short amount of time with Jesus, and then just go home with him? What happened after their meeting with Jesus? Were their lives changed forever? Did they continue to worship Jesus? But Matthew just tells us what he wants us to know. We are told that they are given one final sign, this time not a star, but a dream, warning them not to go back to heaven and to go home via another route. God continues to guide these Gentile worshippers, Gentile meaning non-Jewish, in the same way that he guides all of those who worship Jesus, whether they are Jews or Gentiles, because Christ came for all who trust in him. This passage leaves a lot of things unanswered, and it has caused much supposition, but it most certainly gives us a clear picture of Jesus. It foreshadows, for example, how through him, we who are not Jewish can come before him and worship him as our Saviour. It also shows us how people start rejecting him from an early age. I wonder, are we zealous to come to him? Are we as overjoyed as the Magi were at what is revealed to us about Jesus? Or at times do we just find ourselves disinterested? Do we become just more distracted by the things happening on the earthly world around us, like we saw the people in Jerusalem did? Do we stop looking to discover more about him? Do we joyfully give thanks for God's faithfulness and the fulfillment of his promises to us? Come, let us worship our King before we gather around his table and remember his sacrifice for us. As we sing together, as with gladness, men of old did the guiding star. Thank you. In the book of Revelation we are told, "After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.' All the angels were standing round the throne and round the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, 'Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honour and power and strength be to our God for ever and ever. Amen.' Then one of the elders asked me, 'These in white robes, who are they and where did they come from?' I answered, 'Sir, you know.' And he said, 'These are they that have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple, and he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will lead them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.' The Magi worshipping Jesus foreshadowed that all nations would be able to be saved through the blood of Jesus. It is his sacrifice that we remember as we gather around the Lord's feet. So let us confess our sins, knowing that through him they will be forgiven when we trust in him as our Savior. Father, we gather together with the expectant knowledge that through your Son you freely pardon all who repent and turn to him. We have sinned against you in our thoughts, our words, and our actions. We have not loved you or others as you told us. Grant us the mercy, the forgiveness, and the cleansing that Jesus gives to those who confess their sin. Grant that we may worship you in spirit and in truth, to the glory of your name. Later in his Gospel, Matthew tells us that while Jesus' disciples were eating the Passover meal with him, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." As we share in this simple meal together, we look back to the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, but we also look forward to joining with him as part of the great wedding celebration of the Lamb, with those from every nation, tribe, people, and language. Ruth and Anne will now give thanks for the bread and for the cup.
"Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed." Lord Jesus, we want to thank you this morning for all that you gave up for us. We thank you that you are willing to come from heaven to earth, that we've just been remembering that over this Christmas period. Lord, thank you for your teaching, for your example, for your steadfastness in heading towards Jerusalem, knowing that that is where you were going to be killed. We thank you for this bread that reminds us of your body broken for us on the cross. Lord, we pray that as we take this bread this morning, Lord, that we will remember you. Lord, that you will show us more of what it cost you to do this for us. Amen.
It's your blood that cleanses me. It's your blood that gives me life. It's your blood that took my place in redeeming sacrifice and washes me whiter than the snow. My Jesus, God's precious sacrifice. Dear Lord, words can never express the gratitude that you are due for sending your Son to die for our sins. Thank you, Lord, that Christmas is a great reminder of the baby-born King coming into this world, but that it didn't end there. Jesus died on the cross for my sins so that I can be cleansed and washed whiter than the snow. Thank you for the cup we can drink today, reminding us of the blood shed on the cross for us, so that each one who trusts and follows you may have eternal life. Thank you for the hope it gives us that one day we will be with you in heaven. Thank you, Lord God, for Jesus, your precious sacrifice. Amen.
We in this church operate what we call an open table, and that means that if you love Jesus and trust in him as your saviour, you are very welcome to take part when we pass out the elements between us. If you feel that that doesn't describe you at the moment, or for any other reason you don't want to take part, that is absolutely fine. No reason to be embarrassed, just please pass by the elements and make it clear that you don't want them. When they are passed out to us, you will be given a cup with bread and a cup with juice. Do please take and eat with the bread as it is given to you, but we will retain the cup and have it together to remember us that we are one body, a family in Christ as he died for us. Come, let us proclaim the Lord's death together until he comes again as we share in this meal. Lord and most merciful Heavenly Father, how we thank you that through your grace you sent the Lord Jesus to be our Saviour. Thank you that through him you have brought us, who were once far away, near and into your family and blessing. And that you have destroyed the barrier and dividing wall of hostility that once existed between Jews and Gentiles, and have instead transformed us into one new humanity. May we with one voice continually proclaim the greatness of your gospel, giving all glory and honour to you through praise and thanksgiving. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.